Justice.
So good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to MTOI Series 1, Session 10. Today we have two very special guests, Mr. Venkatraman and Mr. R. Gopal of Goodrich. And we hope that we will have some very good takeaways from their success story. I would request you to kindly put your questions in the Q&A box and not on the chat box. As there will be a Q&A session after this, after the personal interview is over. So we begin. Welcome once again to MTOI Dialogues. The Goodrich story started in the year 1997 when the promoters of the company, Mr. T. Venkatraman and Mr. R. Gopal, incorporated a company called Goodrich Maritime Private Limited in Mumbai, India. The objectives before the promoters were to provide shipping agency services to the Indian trade. In over two decades of its existence, this company has grown in a formidable manner to encompass within its scope activities ranging from various spheres of shipping and logistics. It has expanded geographically from a small presence in Mumbai to various ports and ICDs in India and overseas. Goodrich has an extremely strong presence in locations such as the UAE, Singapore, Indonesia, Malaysia, Thailand, Kazakhstan, Afghanistan, which is now in the news, USA, and Sri Lanka, with a staff strength of over 800 personnel. It is rightly recognized by the Indian trade as the most versatile and the fastest growing logistics company in India. Gentlemen, welcome to MTOI Dialogues. It's a pleasure having you on board. And thank speaking you on the subject, Braving the Storms, which is so apt for both of you.
Thank you.
Before we begin, on a little lighter note, I would like to ask you, how did the name Goodrich come about? I recall Venkat sir telling me once that the story was conceptualized over a tissue napkin in a restaurant, which he still has in his possession. So please tell us that story. Any one of you can take this question.
Okay.
Venkat sir, you have to unmute.
Good evening, everybody. Thanks a lot, Xerxes, for calling both of us for this MTOI Dialogues. We really are planning to enjoy this meeting with all of you all. As far as the name Goodrich is concerned, let me dwell a little on what happened before that. What happened was we left our previous jobs together on the same day with not a clue what we are going to do. So at that time, we were in Nariman Point and we decided that we will drive down, aimlessly drive down. So we told the driver, just go towards Worli. At Worli, we got down. There was a small hotel called Picnic. I doubt whether it is still there.
No, it's not now.
Let us have some tea together. And we sat down facing each other and then said, no more jobs. That is one thing which we clearly decided, no more jobs. And that also for both of us. And then we said, let's do business. So the only business we know was shipping and shipping agency more so. So, and then we said that, okay, we should not restrict ourselves to shipping agency. We listed out all the activities which we are going to do. Believe it or not, most of the activities we are doing today. So the question came of what is the name of the company? Then at that particular point of time, we had no agency in our hand. We had no freight forwarding background as such, because freight forwarding itself was a very nascent concept at that particular point of time. Then we had no big capital in our hand. All that we had was very good business intentions and very rich experience. So we decided to bring both these words together, good and rich. And we said, okay, let's now apply to the ROC for a name approval and call it Goodrich Maritime. That's how the name came about. And sure, this particular phrase, we used it several times. In fact, in our first brochure, in our first advertisement in the trade papers, good intentions, rich experience, Goodrich Maritime.
Wow.
So that's how it came about.
Good. So I bet there was no criteria with the ROC. No one must have ever given that name. So the one option only was enough.
And not anymore also.
Yeah. I can imagine.
But only thing is sometimes on the phone, when you introduce yourself as Venkat from Goodrich, oh, are you working for Godrich?
Godrich.
So,
which is also not a bad thing. Good. That's really good. That's an interesting. And you still have that paper napkin with you, I believe.
Not with me, with Gopal.
With Gopal, okay. So you should frame it and preserve it. It's the beginning.
Yeah.
Okay, good. Moving on. So you have moved into uncharted territories always. And just now I'm bringing up Afghanistan because it's in the news, as we all know. And I think, I don't know anyone else who has got their own office in Afghanistan. It's such a difficult location. I recall you telling me stories of your Indian colleague being there, landing in between, bombs and everything to see that the things are, containers are moving. How did that come about? I mean, why, it's the biggest one, very, very big risk to take. And how was your experience and how did you manage it? So Gopal, would you like to take this?
Yeah. See, when we had a few clients asking, our forwarding division saying that, can you deliver cargo in Afghanistan? We said yes, not knowing how to do it. We went around figuring it out as to how to do it, and someone said you need to land it in Pakistan and then truck it up and things like that. So we said, okay, let's give it a try. Now, of course, we can't go and land in Pakistan because you've got your own restriction there. So we land straight into Afghanistan. Try working backward from there and see how things are done. And then saying, okay, we found okay.
So both of you, sorry to interrupt, both of you went to Afghanistan?
No, only Gopal and
CEO, Saurabh.
Okay.
So Saurabh said, let's go and figure it out. So we went around, found, and honestly speaking, it was not that hostile. Of course, security was always an issue. We're always constantly warned on security, so you got to take care of the security. But then otherwise, the people over there were quite friendly, warm. We even told the Chamber of Commerce, we knocked their doors and said, can we speak to you all? They said, come tomorrow. We went next day, there were 12 of them sitting. They asked us a lot of questions. They were so inquisitive. They want to do a lot of trade with India, in and out. And then we found, okay, it was actually a friendly country with so slightly primitive in their approach and things like that, nothing digital. So everything manual and unique. And one positive thing about the whole thing was they followed the language we spoke.
Okay. Yeah, they're big fans of Hindi films as well. I know. Yes.
So any tea stall you go, you'll find Bollywood music playing. You go to any hotel and things like that, you'll find Bollywood films being played. I think that was part of their culture there. So it was, the penetration was comparatively easy. But then, yes, carrying cargo through the tough terrains, hostile terrains, hostile atmosphere, and things like, yes, that needed a lot of guts, which I would say, thanks to our CEO, he befriended a lot of people in the right places. And then that's how we did it. But enough, I would say that a few years later, we did have some ODC cargoes, which are very, very, very difficult to move around. And then we had to fabricate the vehicles so that, you could pass through all those age-old tunnels in Afghanistan, which actually became a case study in one of the MBA colleges in Delhi.
Wow.
That something impossible was attempted, because there was an abandoned cargo. A forwarder had picked it up and abandoned it in Afghanistan. And then we took it up. It took us 3 months to figure it out as how to go about. But ultimately, yes, we did manage. And then I don't think we had to turn back after that.
Fantastic. And
of course, there are other uncharted territories like CIS and things like that. You would like to have something on CIS?
Afghanistan.
Afghanistan, coming back to it, just before we move on to the next question is, and on the uncharted territories, how have you managed the current change in leadership and the government? Is your office still active? Is it is everything fine?
See, we have three main offices. The main offices are three in three different locations. Apart from that, we have got another 7 or 8 offices that depends on the projects we handle. If the project takes 2 years or 3 years, then we have the offices there for 3 and 4 years.
Okay.
So if you're going to ask us, how is the situation over there? Honestly speaking, the situation is the same. In fact, today we are moving 3 heavy lifts. And then, see, to be very honest, earlier we had a government in place and then we had a hidden enemy to confront. Now we don't have a hidden enemy to confront because they're part of the government.
He's out in the open. Yeah, good, good.
So they welcome us. Everybody welcomes us. If you're in India, you're welcome there, to be very honest.
And my next question is exactly what Venkat sir was going to speak, that you're a truly Desi MNC, you know, truly Indian MNC. You have spread your wings in other places. Can you tell us a little bit about that? Where all?
Yeah. Xerxes, I feel calling Goodrich a Desi MNC, Desi MNC looks a little obnoxious.
Why?
Let us call it. Let us call ourselves an Indian multinational.
Indian multinational. Fair enough. Fair enough. My apologies for that.
Yeah. Xerxes, yes. Apart from the 24 offices in India, we have got right now 22 locations abroad in spanning 4 continents. And in fact, we are the only Asian company to have offices. In fact, not one, 2 offices in the Caspian Sea. In the North Caspian Sea, we have Atirau, and in the South, we have Aktau.
And in Iran? Is that in Iran or?
That is in Kazakhstan. That is in Kazakhstan. And of course, after I finish, Gopal will also explain what kind of business we do there, because it is quite an interesting business and not connected with India at all. Apart from that, we have 16 different activities, 16 distinctive activities we have got. And our ISO tank operation, the global ISO tank operation is really, the tanks are going on a global basis. Our NBOCC activity now spans almost the entire Asia. And we have quite a lot of, almost about 100 odd destinations we serve. So, yes, if you look at it, we have become truly an Indian multinational.
But when you are doing these offices, are they, how long is the gestation period? How long do you invest in it? Or is it immediate you get, you are already having some captive business? And do you keep locals there or you move Indians there to your own people there to run the show?
Majority of the places where it is possible to put Indians, we definitely put Indians. For example, in Singapore, we have got Indians, but it is a combination of Singapore locals and expats. Because getting a visa there in Singapore is a little bit of a challenge because they prefer their local talent to be encouraged. As far as Malaysia is concerned, we have, again, a mixture of the local as well as expats. But Dubai, of course, as you know very well, it's almost nearly 100% of...
it's a suburb of India, I call it.
But yes, we go with captive business. Majority of the times, especially now that we have got Basco and the Global Tanks together. So there is a lot of captive business. So instead of preferring an agency agent, we prefer to have our own office. Because today, agency income is also one of the very important income that we part of our calculations.
Correct. That makes it all the more viable. And also, you have control on the operations yourself.
Correct.
Good. So, I think as he rightly said, the topic today is braving the storms. And I recall, and you all have faced many a storm. One of your biggest storms, I think, if I recall correctly, is your tryst with ship owning, which didn't go exactly as planned. And you know, I think your very existence at that stage probably was in jeopardy, but you came out of it admirably. You faced the storm head on, and you really came out of it in a very flowery, you know, very grand manner. So can you tell us how, what happened exactly and how you bounced back, which is the most important aspect of it?
See, when we started that activity, we started because while we were working in, I was working in Scindia, and then later on joined Gopal and company in Transworld, where we had experience with OEL and Shreyas. So it was not that ship owning was alien to us. So after 7 years, we thought that there was a deep-rooted passion to own ships. And at that particular point of time, we had a third partner. And most of the people in the audience would remember there was a person called Srinivasan, Chino in short. And we all three got together and said, let's look at ship owning. And we drafted in a person who can take care of the ship owning business. We decided that Singapore is the right place because it is a friendly maritime nation. And one of the banks was prepared to fund our acquisition. We decided on the ship very carefully, the right kind of ship, not very expensive. And the most important thing is we could decide on a ship which already had 2 years of balance of charter. That means 2 more years of charter. It was coming with the charter. So to that extent, we were extremely comfortable. So the first 4 years went off very peacefully, and we had good returns.
Which year was this, sir?
2004, we started the business. And until 2008, everything was hunky-dory. Gopal, after that...
Our first ship, I think we did reasonably well. We paid back the bank. The bank was happy. And then we thought, okay, we'll go in for the second one. We went in for the second one. And then I think just a matter of time, say about 4 or 5 months later, we had the Lehman Brothers crashing, and then the whole global economy tanking, ships, charter rates going for a dip. And as you said, rough weather we faced. And then we still continued for a couple of more years. And then we decided, okay, this is taking a lot of our time. A hell of a lot of our time. And then we need probably go back to our core competency. That's box operation. Vasco Maritime and things like that. So we thought, okay, let's take a temporary sabbatical. We can only revisit this area later. So I think... couple of years later, we spoke to the bank. The bank was very, very friendly. They understood the whole thing. They said, yes, we know what's happening in the world. We know what's happening in the maritime industry. Okay, we are prepared to be along with you. So they held our hands for probably 2-3 years more. Till such time, we repaid all our debts. And then, the box operation could be sold. I think we started off about 200 boxes, and then today we are doing about 14,000-15,000 boxes.
Great. Yeah. So you came out of it largely unscathed. You settled your debts. The banks were understanding because of your stellar record, and they had faith in that you will pay your debts off, etc. So that's good. Would you revisit this dream again?
Yeah. Why not?
Okay.
If you want the right opportunity, why not?
Not right now, because the market is so heated up. So probably we have to wait for it to cool down, and then
right now is definitely not the time. Yeah, I agree. Okay, so my next question is to both you gentlemen individually. Anyone can take it before. Your most defining moment in Goodrich's history, according to you, in the 22 decades that it has been in existence, your most defining moment. So please, gentlemen, each one of you.
So where could you go ahead?
The most defining moment for me as far as Goodrich story is concerned is the time we decided to set up our own NVOCC operations. See, when we started, we had a sub-agency. We didn't have an agency as such. The sub-agency is always a risky proposition. anytime the agent might get a little ambitious and then would want to have the business back. So we decided that instead of at that particular point of time, a lot of mainlines were setting up their own agency offices in India. So, and the
business, you're right.
And also the big guys like you, Xerxes, you are already in search for, good agency options.
Yeah. We are still searching.
So we decided we'll have our own liner operation, set up an NBOCC. At that time, we decided that the best option is to be in Singapore because the confidence level to start it in India was not there with all the kind of taxation structures and everything. So we decided to have it in Singapore. That's the time Mr. Srinivasan also joined us. And we started with just 200 boxes, as Gopal said. And now actually it's almost in the region of about 20,000 odd boxes. And we are, what earlier we were doing was only operating the boxes between BPT, that is Bombay Port Trust, and Singapore and Portland. After that, we started rapidly expanding, and now we are traversing the entire all Asian ports, including a little bit of Africa also we do.
Fantastic. So, I mean, okay, and yours, Mr. Gopal, what is your?
Yeah, as far as I'm concerned, I think the year 2019, the month of May, we inaugurated our facility in the JAFSA, that is Dubai Free Zone.
Your liquid tank.
Yeah, we put up a liquid tank storage and ISO tank cleaning facility. So the liquid tanks, we have almost all the classes we accommodate there. Then we have a blending tank. Then we have, you know, a drumming facility. So somebody could come, blend his cargo, we drum it, stuff it, and then send it for them. So I would say a milestone and a forward integration towards our tank operation. And then the other side of it is a modern state-of-the-art tank cleaning facility where we have repairs as well as refurbishment of tanks.
That was
a big dream for us. And then when we had it launched, I would say that was a very defining moment.
Yeah, it's something very unique. You have filled in a gap in the industry which was lacking. You identified it and you filled it in. Great. So just before we wind up, two off-the-cuff remarks. One is that when you made that list on your napkin in the cafe picnic restaurant, did both any of you think you will be where you are today? Did you dream in your wildest dreams, or was this, or you thought, or did you anticipate more than what you currently are?
No. I would definitely say what we have achieved is beyond our anticipation, beyond our, the horizon which we had in mind was totally much smaller than what we have actually reached. I mean, God is really great.
Yes, he is. For you, Gopal sir, same?
Yeah. I would go with what Venkat says. You know, we've grown and we've had a lot of people whom we've carried along with us in this journey. I will not call them employees, I will call them contributors.
Contributors, yes.
They've all contributed. And that's why we stand where we are today.
And I think you started, because that's I'll come to that later. But yes, do you feel that luck has played a big role in your story?
See, luck is something which everybody needs. But then more than luck, I think you have got something called timing.
Right place at the right time.
Right place at the right time, the right people.
Right people.
You've got the right people also.
So
it's a combination of everything.
God has to conspire to make things work, all the elements work.
Okay, so that's the reason Xerxes, many a time I say that we are not two partners, we are three partners. The third partner is Almighty.
Absolutely true. So my last question is that you started, both you gentlemen started your entrepreneurial career pretty late in life. I think in your 40s or earlier than that.
I was 37, Venkat was around 40.
42. Okay. So what's your advice to Indian entrepreneurs, especially entrepreneurs who are currently employees or who are one and who are aiming to become entrepreneurs as well? Like, you know, is it never too late to start? Some people have started the entrepreneur journeys in their 50s and 60s and have made a great success of their stories as well. So what's your advice to Indian entrepreneurs, particularly in our industry, sir? Both of you can take it individually.
Yeah. I would say, guys, take a leaf out of our book. We had really nothing with us, not even no capital, no ready-made agency, but yet we dared to dream. So dare to dream. That's the first advice that I will give them. Be prepared to slog it out. That's most important. Be prepared to slog it out. I can't imagine how many days of leave both me and Gopal would have taken. I mean, you can count it on your fingers. We have always been there. The third thing is, see, I wanted to say something, which if I don't mention, I'll not be doing justice to the people who have helped us. A lot of people have come and helped us along the way. Whether somebody would have given the sub-agency business, somebody would have given some chartering business. So a lot of people have helped us. So gratitude. So my advice to people is gratitude towards people who have helped you. Then, of course, don't fritter away the profits, because I've been in the shipping circle for almost 44 years. I have seen several ups and downs. People used to call it cyclical, but the only thing is the cycle was not equal. Earlier, it was 4 years good and 4 years bad. Now, I mean, then a stage came when it was a few months good and several years bad. That is shipping. And I'm sure your dad would have also told you Xerxes. So many a company folded up. And so don't fritter away your profits. Whatever profits you have, don't fritter it away. I mean, you can save it for later. Invest it and make your money grow. Think about the company and not self.
What do you mean by fritter? Meaning take the funds away for, take it out of the business. You mean you should not do that?
Take it out of the business and, buy some big property for yourself. Don't be avaricious.
Correct. Okay.
So don't throw away the money. Keep the money, invest the money, make it grow, make your business grow. Think about the company and very little about yourself.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Many employees of ours have started their own companies. Our blessings have always been there with them. We still are keeping in touch with them. So, and because each one of them have played a valuable role in the growth, a very valuable role in the growth of Goodrich.
Yeah, I've seen that. Generous on that with your employees who have started off on their own as well. I've seen that myself. That takes character, strong character. Yes, Mr. Gopal, yes.
Apart from what Venkat had to say, what I would like to tell youngsters today is, any bit of information you get, try and develop on that. Don't look at any barriers. And actually, there are no barriers at all. It's all in the mind. Like he told you about, we had an office in CIS. Now the CIS, how it came about. One of our marketing guys came and told us, see, I've been going to a client, he's got a lot of CIS business. But then he doesn't want to do business with us because we do not know how it operates. And the fact of the matter is, we didn't know how it operates. So the next visit, Venkat and me, when we went to Singapore, we went through the local magazine and walked into an office, which was into CIS. He disposed us in 10 minutes time, saying that I'm not prepared to give you any agency. Thank you very much. But then we didn't leave it there. We kept on working on it. We got a guy who knew who got to CIS. Ultimately, we got a guy in CIS who could work things for us. And we always thought it was a business between India and CIS, because that constitutes only 1%. So what we are doing right now there is moving cargo between Europe, CIS, Africa, CIS, America, CIS, things like that. So I think you've got to break barriers. If you break barriers, I think you need to have, as Venkat said, you need to dig. You need to dig. Otherwise, it doesn't happen. Like the offices we opened in West Africa, we were 2-3 of them there in different countries. A couple of visits there, and we found out that if you're not fluent in French, you're finished.
Yes, because they're all ex-French colonies. Absolutely.
Yeah, and nobody wants to talk to you. They don't want to listen to you. So we picked up a few MBA grads from here who knew French. Gave them the rudiments of the business here and put them there. Those guys are doing a fantastic job.
Fantastic.
And there's always a way to beat the system. You need not do anything illegal, but then I think within the system, within the framework, I think if you really apply yourself, especially the youngsters today, move, just keep moving, dreaming and moving.
But sometimes your risk appetite goes low when things don't work out. So you're very scared. If you come out of one mess, you're very scared to again take another risk because you have you jeopardize your family's well-being as well. No, I mean, so you're a little scared about that.
Oh, you start with baby steps always. You start with something small and then you graduate into something big. And you can do it fast because the moment you induce some confidence with the client, he's going to knock your door again.
Correct. So thank you very much, gentlemen. I think we'll stop here. You've given us some very, very good takeaways, at least on the one-to-one, the fireside chat. And it's a very inspiring story, I think. And the growth has been phenomenal. So my compliments and my best wishes for the future as well. I have no doubt that Goodrich is going to grow even stronger and better from
thank
this
you.
Point on. The forum is open.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And the forum is open for any question and answers anyone may have, which we can put on the which you can put in the chat box, and Mr. Gopal and Mr. Venkat would be happy to answer them. Anyone? I think we have covered most of the intentions. Mr. President, do you have any questions before we conclude?
Yeah, thanks, Gopal. Thanks, Venkat.
You said you had a few tricky questions up your sleeve.
Yes, I'm ready with the tricky questions.
Yes.
And at the outset, I want to congratulate my own colleague, Xerxes. Of course, Venkat is also our colleague in managing committee. This is the 10th episode we have, and it's a big success. So a big round of applause for Xerxes. This is our 10th and we are doing it with regularity. And every time it's getting better. And Xerxes will do it for maybe next 50 years. So congrats.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you.
Secondly, I normally feel there is no wrong questions. Answers can be wrong. But I saw that there was a wrong question and there was a corporate communication answer. You asked them, did you imagine will you be so big? So I would say they are courageous people. They dare, they think big. So they gave a humble answer. Because every time I speak to Venkat, he has more people than I had heard last time. He has more containers than I had heard earlier time, and he has more offices. So Venkat, this is a message for you to speak to me more frequently, because
so that will increase the number of
you have more, so it will just accelerate.
Thank you.
It's a good luck charm.
We all look towards you as a role model, and the more you grow, it gives all of us a lot of confidence in times where probably a lot of people have despondency. So you have been, and see, what I appreciate about you the most is you have seen highs and lows, you have bounced back. So that spirit is amazing. That's the real entrepreneurial spirit. And second, a personal note I want to give to Venkat with his permission. We all know he has some health issues, not some, quite serious. You never see it on his face. I used to travel between 90 days and 120 days, but I know Venkat travels, used to travel at least 180 days. And Venkat's visit are 1 day and 2 day. Like if I ask him, where are you going? He says, I'm going to Iran. And he says, okay, I'll be back tomorrow evening. So no complaint about health and he travels. Next, I also learned from him is sometimes for our employee work, we use Sunday. But Venkat has his office review meetings on Sundays. Saturday and Sunday, he has review meetings. So amazing hard work you do. So my question to you is, what will be left for us, Venkat? At least partner with us and take us along. So I want to know from both of you, how will you take us along with you?
Shantanu, having you as a partner, I consider myself to be very fortunate. Such a articulate person, such a experienced person, industry leader. So at any time, I will welcome you as a partner.
Thanks. Now I'm secure already, Venkat. Thanks for that.
We have some questions, Mr. President, which have come in.
Please go ahead. I also have a couple of more questions. I'm happy we have 10 questions.
Please go ahead. Okay. So, I mean, there's a question from Mr. Shiva that how do you see Goodrich in the next 10 years when we are seeing shipping and logistics changing so landscape changing so drastically in the recent times? So any one of you gentlemen can
Gopal
this question.
Can you go ahead?
No, Gopal, you go ahead.
Okay. Goodrich in the next 10 years. Okay. Probably, you know, the NVOCC side of it probably could become a VOCC. Because I told you that we might revisit our shipowning ambitions. So probably we could become a VOCC. So that would change the landscape for the group as such. So that is one way, that's one area I see that we could probably move far ahead. And as far as forwarding goes, I don't know. There's been a lot of consolidation. Even this morning we heard of a very big consolidation. So it can go either way, either you have been offered something or you could offer something else to somebody else. Organic or inorganic growth, however, it does probably that will grow and we could probably get entrenched into more countries where we don't look at India-centric business, we look at cross trades and things like that. So a multinational in the true sense is what we're looking at.
And what's your...
Nada, I would like to add to this that the liquid and gas logistics of ours, that's one thing which is going to grow at the fastest pace. We do have a little bit of a advantage of being the first company to get into IsoBank ownership and IsoBank operation. And as far as India is concerned, I'm sure that this is really going to grow a lot. And we'll add gas tanks also to this.
Fantastic. Next question is, what is your outlook for the next decade? It's from Mr. Ramki that what's your outlook for the industry in the next decade? You partly answered it for Goodrich, but for the industry as a whole? Any one of you gentlemen can take it.
Do you want to talk about the industry?
Well, right now, the way the industry is functioning is something which was not anticipated at all. The kind of five-digit freights is unbelievable. I feel it's a little harsh on the trade. It should not have been there. People, when it started, people were saying that it is short-lived. But even at the end of 1 year, people are now saying that it will carry on till 2022. This augurs well for the industry, but I don't think many trader would be able to function at this with this level of rates.
No, it's not sustainable.
It's not sustainable at all.
Yeah. So my last question. Sorry, go ahead. Sorry, I interrupted you.
No, it's okay.
Yeah. The last question we have to take because we're running out of time is very interesting one, actually. With all your big businesses and troubles and storms, how do both of you keep smiling and being so calm? From Mr. Ritesh Gautam. So that's actually an interesting question, because I've also wondered, you are very cool customers. So how do you?
I looked at my image right now in front of me and I don't seem to be smiling at all.
No, but you're always very chilled out. The worries don't show.
When you're sitting on the seat you occupy, you have people coming with you without a smile. So there is no point in you also having the same kind of expression. So you've got to probably lighten the issue and try to find a solution. That's why you've been approached. So I think calmness is something which is required.
Thank you.
In fact, personally, I would, let me tell you, during the period when our second vessel was taken and the recession was at its peak, we would have died 1,000 deaths. every week, Friday in particular, there used to be some problem with the vessel or the other.
Thus spoiling your weekend, every weekend.
Not only weekend, after that, it was really, I spoke in Shantanu's function. At that time, I described it and I was not able to stop myself. The kind of the tension that we underwent, each one of us. Only thing is, at that particular point of time, the tension was divided among three of us.
Correct. That plays a very important role. But I would like to ask you that, what came to your rescue, yoga or single malts during that stressful period?
Neither of them, actually.
I think it is just a perception of the mind.
Yeah, it's just, as you say, the perception of the mind. And then you know that it's not just one division alone which is going to suffer and going to cave in. You've got the other divisions.
Correct.
They're all doing well. So you've got to probably, move with the tide.
Move with the tide.
Put yourself up and then say, listen, it's only a matter of time. We'll say through.
Thank you.
Everybody has to say through. Everybody faces ups and downs.
In fact, if we were able to brave the storm of the shipowning part, it's only because the other divisions did excellently well. So we could maintain our
liquidity. Correct. So thank you, gentlemen. Once again, Mr. President, I have one remark to make. If you have a closing remark, but unless you have some questions before I hand you the vote of thanks.
Well, I have an offer right now, not a remark, and you can convert it into question. Venkat, I don't know if you have discussed with Gopal. I know for your next level of growth, actually Gopal made my day when he said his next dream is to be a VOCC, something we have been asking, that you be bigger. And in our managing committee meeting, we have all offered to contribute to your share capital, so you don't have to go to the bank for your future funding. I know you have adequate reserves, but whatever meager we can contribute, we will contribute, like the squirrel contributed to building of the Ram Setu, we will also contribute. And we really look forward to have this. And I think the biggest question is how big you can grow and not how big you can grow, how fast you can grow. These are good times, and with this, build your question on this. Darsis, back to you.
No, I have. Yeah, thank you, Mr. President. Actually, no more questions. I think there are many takeaways, and I will just want to make a special announcement to before that, but nothing to do with what you said in the beginning of the session. It's not with pro quo. Already intended to do the same. So first of all, I just want to inform you that we have broken all records. We have our record 112 participants today. It's fitting that series 10, the 10th session has brought in such a big audience, and to Goodrich's bandwidth.
That's people wanting to invest in their venture.
And secondly,
don't you think that is a logical thing to do? Next logical thing to do?
Absolutely. Who has, you have the best popularity, Venkat, I can say that. You have the best popularity. This is the highest participation.
So I think you need to thank Amtoy Dialogues when you buy your next ship, because because your funding is taken care of now.
Thanks.
Thanks a lot for all your best wishes.
No. And one very special note that it's a personal one. I would like to place on record our my personal sincere gratitude and thanks
I think Jersey's is frozen.
Yeah, it's got cut off.
Yeah, I think it's frozen.
We'll wait for 10 seconds and we will start. So actually, Shashi stole my thunder. We had said that Gopal is good and Venkat is rich, was Shashi's comment. And this is what I was to say as a concluding line. But now we see that both of you are both rich, good and wise, and you are still hungry. I think being hungry is what I got from the Venkat, the most. I see him hungry every time. He has urge to grow and grow fast and faster. I think that's very stimulating for always all of us. And keep on growing, Venkat. We all look forward to you. And if you have both of you last concluding remarks, we can have them. Please have last concluding remarks and then we will close the formal session and open for 10 or 15 minutes interactive session, which is not formal, which won't be recorded, which won't be broadcast. So I think Gopal and then Venkat.
What is it?
Your concluding remarks. Message.
Can you hear me now? Sorry,
yeah,
I switched off my video.
Go ahead.
My personal thanks and gratitude to our president. I think this would probably be his last session of Amtoy Dialogues as president. This was his brainchild, and I am personally very indebted to him for his encouragement and making this endeavor successful. He constantly pushed me to push the envelope, as they say, and to go higher and punch above my weight, as he likes to say. And we would still, irrespective who the next successor is, we would still like to be, we would be honored if you will continue to give the vote of thanks in the forthcoming year as well, as and when you can make it and be in attendance, and we hope that would be every time. So once again, Mr. President, our heartfelt thanks for leading this initiative, and my gratitude to you as always.
Thanks. It will be always a pleasure to meet wonderful people we invite for Amtoy Dialogues. And I think what I suggested while you had to log in and log out is both Venkat and Gopal give message or their closing remarks before we close this session. And we have both thanked them, and let us now close with their closing remark and open for the informal session for friends. So once again, thanks and congrats for all your success. Congrats for record attendance in Amtoy Dialogues. And we want this to be exclusive, means don't feel that 110 is not a huge number. Our target for Amtoy Dialogues has been select people, and our range used to be 80 people was the optimal size we had filled. This wasn't a dialogue for masses. This is not about entertainment. This is about people who are hungry to grow, become big, and take inspiration from the stalwart. So this will never be a masses and big number event. It will be a very exclusive event. And that's where Darsis and I shared the passion on this particular initiative of Amtoy. So Gopal and Venkat, closing remarks before we open?
Gopal, you have to unmute. Gopal.
Gopal sir, you have to unmute.
Thank you, President and Success, for inviting us for this talk. Just to steal the President's words, this is for people who are hungry. I should say all of us were hungry at some point of time. I'm sure there are a lot of people who are still hungry. Yes, I hope whatever we exchanged with you all or we shared with you all is a source of inspiration for you all, for everybody. And we also thank the trade and everybody who's been with us in this journey. And let's hope that this little talk we had is inspiring enough to help all budding youngsters that yes, sky is the limit and we can think big. Thank you.
In fact, President Xerxes, we are indeed honored by the invitation to come for this AMTAR Dialogues and the wonderful words from you, President, and Xerxes, the beautiful way in which you have conducted this AMTAR Dialogues month in and month out. And to the enormous number of people, I mean, we are honored that so we have got a record attendance today. So we are thankful to all these people who have attended. Wish them well, and wish them enormous success. The way we have met with success, we wish success for all of you all. Thanks a lot, everybody. Thanks a lot, AMTOY. And for AMTOY, though I am part of it, let me say that Shantanu and Steve have been steered good. I mean, AMTOY to such an extent that we are indeed a number one organization in the industry. Congratulations, President.
Thanks, Venkat.
Thank you,
with
gentlemen.
This very kind and generous note from you, Venkat, we can open up, we can stop recording and open the dialogue for all participants. My request is, when we open up, please speak one at a time, and Xerxes and Delzad will be steering your questions. Please feel free to participate, but let's ensure that we are all heard. With this, please open up for all the friends for informal chat with both our friends.